Welcome to South Lansing Christian Church. It's great to have you here. We want to welcome you who are here in person this morning, and of course we want to welcome all of our friends and family who are with us on our live stream. We're grateful that we have the opportunity to worship God together today, whether you're here or whether you're in your living room or whether you're in another country. All of us are made one through Jesus Christ, and we're grateful that we as His church can connect this morning as we praise and worship the Father. I want to tell you about something new. You know, for the first time, if you came through the front doors for the first time today, you weren't handed a bulletin. That's because we're being touch-free. And so you can go online in our app and you can check out our new online church hub just by pressing that button. And that has all the information that our bulletin has. Our staff, and particularly Jennifer Baddorf, has worked really hard to make that happen. And so we encourage you to check out that. You can download our app at Google Play or at Apple iTunes. And we want you to make sure you do that so we can stay connected with you. I want to remind you today, if you're here in person, make sure you wear your mask the entire time, except when you're taking the communion elements. Because we want to be really sensitive to make sure that everybody feels welcomed. And we want people to feel safe. And in particular, if someone maybe has a higher risk than maybe I do or you do, we want to provide as much safety margin as we can. And so I want to encourage you to wear your mask the whole time. Practice that physical distancing. Don't forget to use the hand sanitizing stations that we've set up outside. We're excited to be able to share together today in this new series, Immerse Beginnings. And we're going to talk more about that in just a minute. But before we do, I want to pray and then we'll stand and worship together. God, it's good to be in this place today with your people. It's good to know that others are gathered with us online and are celebrating, worshiping virtually, not just here in Lansing, but in communities around Lansing and indeed throughout the world. And Lord, may all of our praises be lifted to you today. May you be blessed as we worship your Son. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship together.
You lay down your life. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Sing that again. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. Can't help to admit that, you know, there's just an uneasiness of, all right, are we going to do everything right? Is everything going to work? Everything going to work? Our God is awesome. Everything, we had glitches. God worked it all out so that we can celebrate and proclaim Him. Greater is the one who's in us. Greater is the one who's strong to say He will never fail. Stronger is the one within us. Stronger is the one who fights for us. He will never fail. You will never fail. For your love endures forever. Oh, your love endures forever. Open up our eyes, surround us with your light. Your love endures forever. Mighty is the one who's for us. Mighty is the one who's strong to say He will make a way. Let's sing that again. Mighty is the one who's for us. Mighty is the one who's strong to say He will make a way. You will make a way. for your love endures forever. Oh, your love endures forever. Open up our eyes, surround us with your light. Your love endures forever. Our God is fighting for us always. Our God is fighting for us all. Our God is fighting for us always. We are not alone. We are not alone. Our God is fighting for us always. Our God is fighting for us all. Our God is fighting for us always. We are not alone. We are not alone. We are not alone. We are not alone. Greater is the one who's in us. Greater is the one who calls our name. He will never fail. Stronger is the one within us. Stronger is the one who fights for us. He will never fail. You will never fail. Amen. And our God will not, will not be shaken. Our God will not be moved. Sing that again. Our God will not be shaken. Our God will not be moved. Almighty fortress is our God, unfailing, our helper here among the flood, prevailing. Though the enemy is real, our God is greater still. Our God is greater still. Oh, and our God will not be shaken. Our God will not be moved. Yes, our God will not be shaken. Our God will not be moved. Under the wing of your great love, we're hiding. We tremble not, for you are near. Fighting for the body they may kill. God, you are greater still. You are greater still. Oh, our God will not be shaken. Our God will not be moved. Yes, our God will not. Enemy surrounds and fear has left us bound. Our hope will be found in you. When the enemy surrounds and fear has left us bound, our hope will be found in you. Our God will not be shaken. Our God will not be moved. God will not be shaken. Our God will not be moved. Let's sing that again. Our God will not be shaken. Our God will not be moved. Our God will not be shaken. Our God will not be moved. When the enemy surrounds and has left us bound, our hope will be found in you. When the enemy surrounds and fear has left us bound, our hope will be found in you. 'Cause our God will not be moved. No, our God will not be moved. Yes, our God will not be moved.
As I walked through the building early this morning, I thought to myself, I love the smell of Lysol on Sunday mornings. We're really excited to be back together in corporate worship. It's 6 months to the Sunday today, if you can believe it. It's hard to believe, but we're also excited that we've learned the technologies and we have the capability to continue to stay connected online with those who are at home live streaming. I'm really excited today that we're beginning Immerse Beginnings. And you remember that when we were together in the spring, we had just started Immerse Messiah, where we went through the entire New Testament. We read through the New Testament in 8 weeks. And beginning today, you have the opportunity to be a part of the second component of Immerse Beginnings, where we're going to read through the entire Pentateuch. That's just a Greek word that means five books. The Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible. And we're excited to have you do that, and we want you to purchase a copy of the book so that you can read along with us. This is the New Living Translation. You may be thinking, well, I have the New Living Translation, but this is the New Living Translation without chapter numbers and verse numbers. It's meant to read more sort of like a story, right? And so we want to encourage you to pick up a copy of the book. You can do so at the guest services counter for $10, or if you're following along at home, let us know. We'll set one aside for you, and you can drop by and pick one up when you're out. In 8 weeks, if you'll give it about 10 pages a day, you'll read through the entire first five books of the Bible in 8 weeks. Now, there's also a secondary reading schedule for 16 weeks. You know, if 10 pages a day just doesn't fit with your calendar, you can read through in 16 weeks. And all of that information can be found at our website, seekstudyserve.org/Immerse. In addition to reading through the book, we want you to participate in a book club. And we've had book clubs scheduled all throughout the week at different times and at different places. I'm going to be hosting one yet. I haven't even scheduled mine yet because I'm waiting to see if there are a group of people who want to be a part of a book club but maybe don't have one that fits our schedule. So if you're thinking, you know what, I've looked through that list, Frank, and none of those fits my schedule, go ahead and contact us because I'm planning to schedule a book club for those maybe who just don't have one that works for them just quite yet. So we want you to read through Immerse Beginnings in 8 weeks. We want you to be a part of a book club so you can have conversations about what you're reading. And then the third thing is, every day when you read and every Sunday as we gather together, I want us to pray this prayer together, to make this our prayer to God during this season of Bible study. Let's all pray together. Here we go. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, grant, we pray, that we might be grounded and settled in your truth by the coming of your Holy Spirit into our hearts. What we do not know, reveal to us. What is lacking within us, make complete. that which we do know, confirm in us and keep us blameless in your service through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The first time I met Abraham, the biblical character that you're going to be reading about this week in Immerse, was in Sunday school as a first grader in Mrs. Key's class. I met him on something called flannel graph. Some of you know what flannel graph is, others might not recall it, but flannel graph is kind of what it sounds like. It was, a board about this size, but it wasn't a chalkboard, it was covered with flannel. And our teachers would sort of get these sort of die-cut dolls like you see on the screen, and they would sort of punch those out. And on the backside, there was a flannel surface, and I don't know how it worked. There's some physics, principle involved there. But they'd put flannel Abraham up on flannel graph and flannel Sarah and flannel Isaac as they told the story, and it kind of illustrated the story. It was sort of like magically adhered in our little first grade minds. It never occurred to me at the time that Abraham was a big deal beyond First Church of Christ in Garrett, Indiana. But it turns out Abraham was and is a pretty big deal. He is international. Of course, American churches thought Abraham was a big deal, but Abraham's an even bigger deal in Jewish synagogues. Abraham even gets honorable mention as a prophet in mosques throughout the world. Abraham is no flash in the pan. He's no one-hit wonder like Omarosa or Boston Rob, right? Abraham has been around. He's going to be around. The Jews consider him the father of Judaism. The Muslims consider, actually honor Abraham for his obedience to God's word and for ridding the world of idolatry during his time. And of course, the Christians recognize Abraham as Jesus' ancestor through whom all the nations of the world have been blessed. But Abraham is more than just an important historical figure to you and me. Abraham sets the standard for a characteristic that is essential for every person who wants to follow Jesus. It's an indispensable quality. In fact, the Bible tells us that if you don't have this quality, it's impossible to please God. If you don't have this characteristic in your life, it's impossible to be saved. You have to have this quality in your life in order to inherit eternal life. And if you have this quality, the Bible tells us that you can move mountains. The Bible tells us that your prayers will be answered. The Bible tells us that you will experience adoption as God's child, and that all of the promises of heaven are included in your future. In short, this trait is the defining characteristic of a follower of Jesus. This quality, this trait, this characteristic is faith. And as we begin Immerse together this week, I want us to look at how Abraham demonstrated faith. The first mention we have of Abraham is in Genesis chapter 11. He's living in the time in what is now southern Iraq with his father Terah and his siblings. His father decided to migrate to Canaan, what is now modern day Israel. And so Terah took Abraham and Abraham's wife Sarah. He took his nephew Lot, and they moved toward Canaan, but they stopped in the city of Haran, which is in what is now southern Turkey. We don't know why they stopped. They were on their way to Canaan. They kind of stopped halfway there. We don't know why. Now, at this point in Genesis 11, Abraham is referred to as Abram. Sarah is referred to as Sarai. And so as you're reading in Immerse this week, you'll see those names. I want you to know they're interchangeable. Abram, Abraham, same person. Sarah, Sarai, same person. Why is that? It's because when God gives a person a special call on their life, quite often what God does is change their name to reflect their changed status under that new calling. And so you'll see Abram referred to as Abraham, Sarah referred to as Sarai. They're one and the same person, and we read about them in Genesis 12. Genesis 12, verse 1. The Lord had said to Abram, leave your native country, your relatives, and your father's family, and go to the land that I will show you. I think it's difficult for us to really comprehend the depth of this calling, the gravity of this new calling. God tells Abram, leave your native country. In other words, he's basically saying you're going to become a person without a country. It's a true fact that humans are very often tied to places. I grew up in the Hoosier State, God's country. We have a saying in Indiana that you can take the boy out of Indiana, but you can't take Indiana out of the boy. And I know there are a lot of people that feel the same way about Michigan. I mean, they love the fact that, you know, the sun rises along the shores of Lake Huron and it sets along the shores of Lake Michigan. They love the mountains and the western upper peninsula and the flatlands of the southern lower peninsula. Not only can many Michigan people pronounce Tequamanon Falls, they've actually been to Tequamanon Falls. There's an old Rich Mullins song that says, the stuff of earth competes for the allegiance I owe only to the giver of all good things. And that's really true. We're tied to place, many of us. And imagine God coming to you and saying, I want you to leave your native country and go to the land that I'm going to show you. What are you talking about, God? Leave my native country? But that wasn't all Abraham was called to leave. He was called to leave his relatives. Now, there are a lot of folks, let's just admit, there are a lot of folks who'd be fine with leaving some of their relatives. Some of them may come to mind at the moment. But the fact of the matter is, I like my aunts and uncles. I like my cousins. It'd be difficult for me to imagine leaving them. And fortunately, I don't have to. My nearest cousin lives about an hour away, and all of my cousins, my aunts and uncles, they're easily accessible through telephone, and we can just call them up. But not Abram. Abraham didn't have cell service in Haran. He didn't get email. He didn't have telegraph. There wasn't even Pony Express, and certainly no USPS. Leaving Haran for Abram meant saying goodbye to his family. So long. But Abram's calling meant not just saying goodbye to his family, it meant something else. There was a third thing he had to leave behind. He had to leave behind, God said, your father's family. You see, Abraham was the firstborn of his family. He was Terah's inheritor. And for him to leave behind his father's family meant he was leaving behind the prestige that he had as firstborn son of Terah. Let me ask you, what have you left behind to follow God? Because God always calls us to leave something behind when we follow him. And if you're not sure what it is you've left behind in order to follow God, then you've got to really ask, am I following him? What have you left behind to follow God? German martyr Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote, when Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die. God's call on Abraham's life was essentially a call to leave behind his old way of life, to die to his old way of life, and to live to the way of life that God had called him. Now, what's amazing is that God calls him to leave something behind, but then God also gives Abraham a promise. Here's what he said in verse 2. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you and make you famous, and you will be a blessing to others. I can imagine Abraham scratching his head at that one. Because Abraham was an old man, his wife Sarah was well past her childbearing years. They had no sons, they had no daughters, and yet God was telling Abraham that he was going to be the father of a great nation. How's it possible Abraham was going to be the ancestor of a great nation when he didn't even have any children? But that wasn't the only promise that God made Abram. He said, you're going to be the father of a great nation. And he said, I'm going to make you famous. A more literal translation there is, I'm going to make your name great. And 4,000 years later, we know that to be the case, that Abraham's name is great in multiple religions throughout the world. He is indeed famous. And then there's a third promise here. God says, I will make you into a great nation. I will make your name great. And then God says, and you will be a blessing to others. Verse 3 gives us more detail about that part of the promise. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who treat you with contempt. All the families on earth will be blessed through you. Do you understand today that you're included in that promise? When God told Abraham, all the nations of the earth will be blessed through you, he was thinking of you. All the nations of the earth are blessed through the promise God made to Abraham. Now, Abraham, I'm sure, couldn't have known the depth of what all of that meant, but we do, because we have hindsight that sees back 4,200 years to Abraham, but also 2,100 years to Jesus. We're able to see back and understand that God was talking about Jesus. Through Jesus, Abraham's descendant, all the nations of the earth have been blessed. Now, here's the thing. If you heard a voice telling you to leave and go, if you had a dream or a vision where God instructed you to pick up and move, what would your reaction be? We know what Abraham's reaction was. Verse 4 said, so Abram departed as the Lord had instructed, and Lot, that's his nephew, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he left Haran. He took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, and all his wealth, his livestock, and all the people he'd taken into his household at Haran, and headed for the land of Canaan. You see, Abraham had the faith to believe God. Three chapters later, God repeats this promise to Abraham to make him into a great nation. He tells him that your descendants will be as numerous as the sand on the seashore, as many as the stars in the sky. Too many to count, God tells him. And Genesis 15, verse 6 says, and Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord counted him as righteous, you ready? Because of his faith. Imagine the faith that must have taken. Imagine the faith that must have been required for Abraham to believe that his descendants would be as many as the grains of sand on the seashore. Because even if Abraham lived long enough to see a son or daughter miraculously conceived with his elderly wife, even if he lived long enough to see that, he had to take it on faith that he would become the father of a great nation, because he would never see those subsequent generations who would make up the millions upon millions of his children. He had to take it on faith. The fact is, faith is all Abraham had. But you know what? Faith was all he needed. There's a book in the New Testament that's written specifically to the children of Abraham, to the Jews. The Epistle to the Hebrews. We're not entirely sure who wrote it, but we know who the audience was. It was those Jewish people who were trying to figure out who Jesus was. And Abraham's a star player in the book of Hebrews. Here's what chapter 11, verse 8 says about Abraham. It was by faith that Abraham obeyed when God called him to leave home and go to another land that God would give him as his inheritance. He went without knowing where he was going. And even when he reached the land God promised him, he lived there by faith. For he was like a foreigner living in tents. And so did Isaac and Jacob, his son, his grandson, who inherited the same promise. Abraham was confidently looking forward to a city with eternal foundations, a city designed and built by God. You see, Abraham knew something that we all have to learn at some point, and it's this: faith faces forward. Every promise that God gives his children is rooted in the future. It's a future promise that God gave Abraham. And God gives us future promises too. God has promised that there will someday be a place and a time where he will wipe away every tear from our eyes. There's the promise of freedom from pain and freedom from sorrow. How is that fueled? It's fueled by hope in the future. You see, Hebrews 11 doesn't just talk about Abraham. It talks about Sarah, and it talks about his son and his grandson, and it talks about generations of his descendants. It mentions the heroes of the Old Testament that you'll read about in the coming weeks and months. And every one of them had a forward-facing faith. Hebrews 11, 13, all these people died still believing what God had promised them. They did not receive what was promised, but they saw it all from a distance and welcomed it. They agreed that they were foreigners and nomads here on earth. Obviously, people who say such things are looking forward to a country they can call their own. If they had longed for the country they came from, they could have gone back. But they were looking for a better place, a heavenly homeland. That is why God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. You know, there's some people in life who spend all their time looking backwards and second-guessing, ruminating on their regrets. They get so stuck in the past, wishing they could go back, wishing they could have a do-over, filled with regret for the way that they've lived their lives. They're so stuck in the past that they can't face forward. There are some people who are so mired in the present, looking down where they're at their difficult experiences, stuck in the mud of shame or despair or heartache, so stuck in their present circumstances that they're not able to face forward. Friend, God has called you to face forward in faith. I want you to know that whatever circumstance you're in right now, you can face forward in faith, knowing that God has promised that if you're His child in faith, there is a homeland for you where there will be no more sorrow or crying or pain or tears. It's easy to get stuck in the present, especially in the midst of a global pandemic. But I promise you, it will not always be this way. It's going to get better. It might not get better right now. It might not get better soon. In fact, it might not get better in your lifetime. You may have to look at that great city from afar, just as our heroes of Hebrews 11 did. But that's okay. You and I, we're just nomads here on this earth, just like Abraham. Our homeland is a heavenly homeland. And when you have a faith that faces forward, God is not ashamed to be called your God. For He has prepared a heavenly city for you. Let's pray. I thank you, Lord, for the promises that sustain us in difficult times, for the promises that give us a hope and a future when we struggle with regret from the past. I thank you for your son, Jesus, Abraham's descendant, through whom all nations of the earth have been blessed, and in whom our faith is focused. When we become discouraged, Lord, help us to face forward in faith. When we're in need of hope, help us to face forward in faith, claiming those promises that have sustained your followers from the time of Abraham up until now. In Christ's name we pray, amen. I learned Genesis 12, 1 through 3, my freshman year of college. God said to Abraham, I will bless you, make you into a blessing. Those who bless you, I will bless. Those who curse you, I will curse. And all the nations of the earth will be blessed through you. Do you get that he's talking about Jesus there? Do you get that when he says all nations of the earth will be blessed through you, Abraham, he's talking about Jesus going to the cross and paying the price for our sin so that we can be adopted into Abraham's family, so we become his heirs. So all that is inherited by his sons and daughters is now inherited by us. We're Abraham's children through faith in Jesus Christ. And we celebrate that this morning as we come together to receive the Lord's Supper, to eat bread that reminds us of Jesus' body, bruised, battered, and beaten for us. That reminds us of His blood, a sacrifice once for all time. So that no longer, like the patriarchs, do we have to offer the sacrifice of lambs and goats, because the blood of the pure Lamb of God, Jesus, has taken away the sins of the world. And so, as you celebrate communion today, whether here in this location or at home, remember, you are God's child, an adopted son or daughter of Abraham. We're going to sing together, and as we do, take a moment and reflect on that truth and be encouraged by it.
spread out the skies over empty space. Said, let there be light to a dark and formless world. Your light was born. You spread out your arms over empty hearts. Said, let there be light to a dark and hopeless world. Your son is born. You made the world and saw that it was good. You sent your only son, for you are good. What a wonderful maker. What a wonderful savior. How majestic your whispers. Humble your love with a strength like no other, and the heart of a father. How majestic your whispers. What a wonderful God. No eye has fully seen how beautiful the cross. We have only heard the faintest whispers of how great you are. You made the world, saw that it was good. You sent your only son, for you are good. What a wonderful maker. What a wonderful savior. How majestic your whisper. Humble your love with a strength like no other, and the heart of a father. How majestic your whispers. What a wonderful God. And saw that it was good. You sent your only son, for you are good. What a wonderful maker. What a wonderful savior. How majestic your whisper. Humble your love with a strength like no other, and the heart of a father. How majestic your whisper. What a wonderful God. How majestic your whispers. What a wonderful God. Thank you. kindness of mercy that bought with blood wholeheartedly a soul undeserving. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. Behold the cross, age to age, hour by hour. The dead are raised, the sinner saved. Work of your power. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. Oh, yes, God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. I am blessed, I am called. I am healed, I am whole, I am saved in Jesus' name. Highly favored, anointed, filled with your power for the glory, Jesus' name. I am blessed, I am called, I am healed, I am whole. I am saved in Jesus' name. Highly favored, anointed, filled with your power for the glory, Jesus' name. And should this life bring suffering, I will remember what Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. Oh, and God, you're so good. God, you're so saved. are so good. God, you're so good. You're so good. Let's sing that one last time. God, you're so good.
Be seated because it's time for our offering. Yeah, I'm excited to receive our offering today because we've just declared how good God is to us, and now we can demonstrate that through giving back to Him. As you walked in, you no doubt noticed that there's some different things. Things are different than they used to be. There's some signs, and there's some sanitizing stations, and there's there's all kinds of different stuff. And that stuff doesn't come free. You know, we've had to spend some money in order to make folks safe, and we're happy to do that. And we can do it confidently because we know you're generous. And time again, when a need has arisen, you guys have risen to the occasion. And I just wanted to say thank you, thank you, thank you. There are three ways that you can give. You can give through our SLCC app, which you can get at Google Play or at the Apple iTunes Store. You can give at our website, seekstudyserve.org/give, or you can text 517-305-2055 and text your gift to us. Oh, and there's a fourth way you can give. You can give when you come to church on Sunday, and you can drop it in the black boxes at the tables where you picked up your offering. And I just wanted to say thank you for your faithful giving. Let's pray together. God, you are good to us. And as we demonstrate our gratitude for that goodness right now, we pray your blessing upon the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we're about to wrap things up, but I wanted to just, before we get out of here, to ask you express thank you to some of our volunteers and our staff who've just done some incredible work. You know, the stuff that you see, I mean, you get it, right? That it takes a lot of volunteers, it takes a lot of hard work to make things happen, but there's a lot of stuff that you don't see because, you know, it used to be we had to have one person to run the sound person, you know, to run the sound, one person to run the slides, and now we have to have one person run the sound and slides for the room, and a different two people to run sound and slides for the live stream, and we have people to do lights, and we have people to monitor the live stream and have conversations with people who are tuning in to us on the live stream. And so it's just taken a ton of volunteers. It requires a lot of people to now sanitize this room. And so as you leave, there are going to be people who come through behind you at some point and hose the place down with Lysol, right? And clean the bathrooms the same way and the lobbies in Kid City. And it's just taken an entire raft of volunteers. And as your minister to each of those people, to our staff, to our volunteers, to our leaders, I just wanted to say thank you, and I wanted to give you the opportunity to tell them thank you, too, perhaps by way of applause. Yes. And I wanted to say thank you for allowing the Holy Spirit to descend upon your glasses. Those of you who have glasses and wore masks today, I appreciate you continuing to wear those masks. Thank you. I have said before that a measure of a person's spiritual maturity is their willingness to be inconvenienced for the sake of others. And you've demonstrated that this morning, and I just wanted to say thanks for that. I want to encourage you to try five. If you're here for the first time, we want you to try us out five times because I'll bet it won't be the same any five times you're here, right? It's an ongoing kind of evolving thing that's happening here as we learn how to survive and thrive in a post-COVID world. And so we just want to encourage you to come back and try us out five times. And when you try us out five times, we think you'll know if this is the church for you. And if you're joining us online, we want to encourage you to invite five people to join you online as well. And we'll drop a link in the chat line of our live stream that you can send to your friends, your family, and invite them to join us online too. So try five and invite five. And then finally, years ago, I went to a restaurant in Chicago called Ed DeBevick's. Anybody ever been to Ed's? Oh, wow, we have some Ed DeBevick's fans, yeah. And it's a place where the waiters and the waitresses are all basically starving actors, right? They're people who are in the theater, but they got to have a day job. And so the actors who, you know, are your waiters, they're intentionally rude to you, right? That's the shtick at Ed DeBevick's. They're intentionally rude to you. People go there to be insulted, and it's a lot of fun. But I remember one of the things that they said at Ed's, because it's always packed, there's always a line out the door at Ed's. There's this announcement, as I'm standing in line waiting to get into Ed's, there's this announcement, they come on and they said, if you've eaten and paid the bill, there's nothing left for you here. Please leave. I thought, how rude. Well, listen, if you've eaten today and paid the bill, we need you to leave as soon as we're done, okay? I'm not trying to be rude. I'm really not. It's just we want you to visit with others, but we ask that you do so in the parking lot where the cool breeze can blow the coronavirus far away from you and your friends. And so we encourage you to leave this morning just as soon as we're done and spend as much time as you like visiting in the parking lot. It's so good to see all of you, or at least this much of you today. I'm really encouraged, and for those of you who joined us online, thank you. We look forward to staying connected to you through our ongoing live stream. Let's stand and pray as we're dismissed from this place. Father, as we leave this place, we go knowing that we are blessed, that we are healed, that we are whole, that we're saved in Jesus' name, and that through Jesus, but through whom all the nations of the world have been blessed, Lord, we have adoption as your children into Abraham's family. Now, Lord, help us to live this week like your sons and daughters. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Go in peace.